So let us kick off this session, which is rather free-ranging because it's on developers and financiers and EPC. So perhaps we'll try to make the discussion a little contextual to the changes which have happened in the recent past, in the last quarter specifically, which are impacting various panelists and the entire ecosystem around us, given these changes. Can I just request the panelists to quickly introduce themselves first, and then after a quick round of introductions, let's have an opening statement, and then we can have a discussion amongst ourselves and then involve the audience in any kind of questions that they have. Is that okay? Sure. So if you have another mic there, or if it's not working, I'll pass this around.
Good morning, everyone. I hope most people are rather interested in tea than the session. So Ritu, we would have tough time, but we'll make sure that we'll make it up for it. My name is Kapil Maheshwari. I am CEO for Hinduja Renewables. I have seen solar from a design engineer to a CEO journey last 13 years. Maybe most people might have not seen 13 years, but and various places from US to Germany to India, and various segments from utility to rooftop to developers to selling products from inverters, panels, working on bankability studies globally. So hope I would be able to provide some insights to whatever we take the session forward. Thank you.
Thanks, Ritu. Good morning, everyone. My name is Hiten. I work with Everest Industries Limited. We are India's largest roofing and pre-engineered building company. Thank you.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. This is Rahul. I'm lead open access for AmpSolar. So AmpSolar, basically a Canadian company, started in 2009. We are the largest distributed generation company in Canada. Now we are present in Canada, Japan, UK, US, India. Now we are starting operations in Australia as well. So we have managed over 32,000 of projects, investment made of around 1.5 billion. And now we started in 2016 in India. And now we are basically developing rooftops, open access, and government tenders. So this is what we are doing. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I am Sabyasachi Majumdar, Senior Vice President with ICRA Limited. We are a 51% subsidiary of Moody's, and we are a credit rating agency, and hopefully during the course of the panel discussion, I might be able to shed some light upon how we evaluate the risks, what we see as the key risks from a financing point of view for in renewable energy projects.
Hi, this is Ritu Lal, and I'm from AmpPlus Solar, and we are among the largest distributed solar power developers in the country, working primarily in the rooftop segment and in open access in states where the policy allows it.
Good morning, all. I'm Jay Chandra. Heading the rooftop solar division in Sterling and Wilson. I have around 15 years of solar experience, starting from Tata Power, erstwhile Tata BP. I have more of execution background, right from 1 watt panel systems to the megawatt scale projects in the execution. Right now I'm heading the solar rooftop and distributed solar division in Sterling Wilson. Thank you.
Good morning, I'm Pratyush Thakur. I'm heading operations for StartCraft BLP Solar Solutions. We are a distributed solar developer owned by Norway's StartCraft and India's Bharat Light and Power. In the group, we carry out all kind of activities related to renewable energy. We develop and own hydropower projects, wind power projects, solar power projects. We provide power trading solutions to commercial industrial companies. We provide in the group remote monitoring solutions to developers, other developers across the globe. So we are a full service renewable energy company.
Hi, good morning to all of you. I am Sundar Rajan. I represent CleanTech Solar and I take care of Karnataka and Tamil Nadu operations. Prior joining to CleanTech Solar, I was working with GE Motors taking care of the South Indian operations. I look forward to the session. Thank you.
Okay, so we have a rather large panel and comprising EPC. What is interesting is probably for the first time we have EPC dedicated to the rooftop segment. So far, usually when we tend to have panelists, we have EPC on the grid scale plants. So it will be very interesting to have your comments, Jayachandra. And then there's a lot of developers. There is a finance credit from ICRA. And of course, Hinduja, which is in the grid scale as well as in the rooftop segment, right? And I don't think I've missed anyone out here, right? No. Okay, so in case panelists would like to have give an opening remark, if you don't want to and you want to move straight into discussions, that's also okay. But you know, maybe 2 to 3 minutes, if you would like to make an opening remark, starting with this side now, starting with Sundarajan. Sorry? Any opening remarks on the discussion? You don't have to. So if you wish to have make an opening remark or a statement.
Is it there? Yes. Okay, very short remark. I think all of us here are pretty happy about the kind of growth solar power sector has seen in last few years. It's been driven by, I think, quite a few things getting right. There has been a lot of focus from the government to promote clean energy. It's been through ramping up the solar power plan, having very, very ambitious INDCs in the Paris Convention. There is a lot of support, at least in what they say. There is also a lot of capital coming in the sector. So you see here a lot of companies, including ourselves, owned by foreign companies, could be private equity investors or utilities. So the whole world is looking at India as a growth engine. The solar panel prices have come down significantly from what they used to be 5 years back. And hence, that helps the whole viability of solar against other sources. I think barring the recent wind tender, I think solar was doing even better than wind, at least in the utility scale. So a lot of things are getting right. There's a huge opportunity, but still on the distributed sector, especially, the growth is not that fast. And the deployment, which you would expect, the government wants 40 gigawatts by 2022. I'm sure none of the panelists will put a finger on that we will go there. And there are several reasons for that. There are uncertainties on policy, which I believe is one of the greatest factors for less deployment. There's a lot of customer awareness, which is also required. You know, everyone looks at the headlines and the tweets the previous minister used to come out with. But people don't understand that a large-scale 750 megawatt solar is different from a small-scale 75 kilowatt solar. So the potential is tremendous. We have some challenges, and I'm sure there'll be more insights in this panel discussion, but if we have got some good solutions to the challenges, especially on how we as an industry can standardize some stuff to ensure that some risks of quality, of contracting, of financing are taken care of, then I think we will be able to reach the potential which the sector has.
Thanks, Pratyush. Jayachandra, you want to say something?
Yeah. I see the whole gamut of activity, and normally, I mean, many times I have tried to compare that to a marriage where there are a lot of stakeholders like parents or the customer or the bride and bridegroom itself, and there are other people who build into that, pitch in between and then vanish afterwards. So how to make the marriage happen should be, I think, the theme of discussion.
Okay. I will come back to you first when we begin, but Sabyasachi, anything?
I speak very frequently at conferences dedicated to renewable energy, and one of the most common question is, are we going to achieve the target of 175 gigawatts which the government has announced? Now, my reply is that as a rating agency, I mean, from the financing perspective, we don't really, it's not really so much important whether we do 175 or 75 or 100. From the stability perspective, both from the power purchaser side as well as the financial side, what is important is that whatever is added should be financially sustainable. The system should be in a position to absorb that. The tariff should not be so low that the project viability gets impacted, and the tariff should not be so high that the off-taker own financial position, because we are aware of what the DISCOM finances are like, are put to stress. And there are a lot of things which have to be sorted out, off-take arrangement, transmission arrangement, arbitrary renegotiation of PPAs, or use of grid back down as an excuse for not picking up power. So those are the issues we are really concerned about, and addressing those issues will be quite critical from perspective of ensuring renewable taking off in a very sustainable sort of way.
So in 2003, the government started talking about the competition, and they started bringing this open access concept into the market. But the way it has developed till today, it's not very significant, I say. And in last, 1 or 2 years, it is going on a downside only. This is what I can say, based on my understanding. So today, because of the policy uncertainty, and there is no prediction about the open access charges which is going to impose on the open access transactions, is what I feel is one of the topic which can be addressed here and can be discussed, and maybe we can find some solution for it.
We as a roofing and a building company, we are seeing that almost 25% of new buildings are requesting for solar compliant features to be inbuilt on the building, which is very encouraging, not only for us but also for the solar community in general. And the customers are really delighted when you tell them that there are possibilities to get solar rooftop at a zero capex, and thanks to companies like Amplus, CleanMax, CleanTech, and of course Hinduja is one of the largest, this revolution is just getting accelerated, in our opinion. Thanks a lot.
I guess we have more distributed solar people on the dais, so I will not take that because you would provide more insights. Two things I would like to put in the opening mark is, we're discussing a lot about tariff going down. So these tariffs going down is good, because then you have access to a lower priced solar power available to you. But at the same time, what we also need to understand that these tariffs are also in turn would put a higher risks to the earlier projects which were done at an higher tariffs. So how are we balancing that? So maybe we'll discuss that a little bit more on that. And the second would be, we all talk of policy, but policy on paper is very good in India, but policy on an implementation side is always a hassle when a developer and EPC company looks at it. I'm not saying that tariffs part was a complete speculation. I mean, nobody invests crores of rupees with speculation, and none of the developers who have bid for that are, they are good institutes to put their money. So they will not do it on speculation. People always do within little calculated risk. Risk does exist, and that's a reason of reward of winning that contract. So that exists. But at the same time, on the policy front, we say, okay, Karnataka is one of the most encouraging state for open access project, because for solar at least, because they have a 10-year period where there's no open access charges on this, and it's reasonably implemented well as well. But where are the other states? Why are they not following such a thing? I mean, to encourage
Where do we see MNRE role in providing comfort to developer? One of a recent example which comes to me, I mean, look, today there's a news article which says around 1,000+ containers are stuck at Chennai port for no reason. Solar modules have no 7.5% duty, but it is stuck, although MNRE has given a letter. But where is the policy to enforce and implement such things? MNRE also gives letters saying that must run status for solar, no back down, all tariffs needs to be honored. Still there are news articles which keep on talking of PPA renegotiation. So this word which is minted in last 4 months doesn't exist actually, because there's no way PPAs were renegotiated. Either these were bids which were not done and then regulators have a loophole to do something there. But so we need to be cautious in all that while taking it forward to the 100 gigawatt target in solar.
Thanks everyone for their opening remarks. The thing that struck me immediately was Jayachandra's statement on it being a marriage. Yes, there are a lot of stakeholders, but I'm very interested to know who the bride and groom are, in your opinion.
See, bride and groom are the customer. See, ultimately the user, end user who gets the power is the bride and groom. In the marriage also, ultimate beneficiary for the entire set of functions which happen is for the bride and groom. Yeah, they should be, but see, ultimately once the marriage is happens, I mean, bride and groom becomes one as a family. So I think that's the customer.
Okay, thank you so much. Beginning with the policy uncertainty. So we understand that electricity is a state subject. We have guidelines, and then there are 29 policies, probably maybe a little less. Some states may have identical policies, but there is a lot of disparity between what is allowed. We would all probably unanimously agree that the most liberal, solar liberal policy is in Karnataka, right? And among the industrialized states, among the toughest to crack is probably a Gujarat, that's been our opinion. So the question is it, in your opinion, is it something to do with at the policy level, or is it something to do with an unwillingness to commit? And if it is either of the two, whether you know the policy is not clear, why is the policy not clear, given that CERC guidelines are there, MNRE guidelines are there, you have leading states in solar which are coming up with, you know, the reaping the rewards of it. If you look at the amount of open access alone that Karnataka has been able to get. So whether it's from, you know, not getting there as yet, or whether it is, no, this is something to be feared, or is this is something harmful? What's your take? Just feel free to just raise your hands and answer whoever wishes to take this question on. I know it's a slightly controversial subject to bring in right at the beginning, but what is holding the governments back in fully engaging with solar?
Yeah, my views may not sync with many others. The issue is that even Karnataka, when the policy had come, Karnataka was a deficit state. And there was a lot of promotion from the government to bring in more generation capacities. Let us look at the overall state of demand and supply on the wholesale side. And at least what CEA publishes, that we have a huge glut of supply in the country. Now, it might be an irony that we still have power cuts and a lot of, you know, a huge proportion of the population doesn't have electricity. But at least on the wholesale side, we have got about, if not more, 330 gigawatts of capacity and a 150 gigawatts of peak demand. So the DISCOMs, who are already in a very, very bad financial state, all of us know, they're not in doing well, they have no incentive to support us developers taking out their customer. And if we say that, you know, it is unreasonable, I don't think it is unreasonable. If my house is on fire, I'll try to bring whatever measures I can do to set out that fire. But does that help in India achieving the targets it has for renewable energy? Probably not. So, you know, my view is that there should be all stakeholder, and it has to be done in different states. There has to be public hearings where the all stakeholders, which is the customer, the utility, which is the distributing and transmission company of the state, regulator, as well as the developers, they all sit together and decide how the value has to be distributed. Let me just put some numbers, and these are quoting hypothetical numbers, could also be true. In Karnataka, a commercial customer, a hotel owner, ITC here, would pay 8 rupees as variable charge to the DISCOM. But today, if Ritu or I or CleanTech goes to them, we'll offer them 5 rupees as a price for a 10-year contract. Okay, you buy at 5 rupees, and these are hypothetical, at least a 5-1. There's a value of 3 rupees for the customer. Let us also see how much value is the DISCOM making, how much money is the DISCOM making? Zero on this transaction. Of course, they take some demand charges, but demand charges are not good enough for the DISCOM to really compensate for the infrastructure they operate or the fixed cost they have. Yes, they might be inefficient, but the issue is that there's a 3 rupee per unit value which is being transferred to the customer. I'm sure none of the developers is making 3 rupees. We are not working at 60% returns. So say developers are making 10% return and a 50 paisa. We are making 50 paisa, the customer is making 3 rupees, and the DISCOM is making nothing or probably a loss. And this is heavily skewed. So a consensus has to be arrived at how the value should be distributed. I mean, it is oversimplification, these numbers.
So is your view that the you know, the policy engagement from the state side, from the government side, is still kind of you know, one step forward, one step back, because of the impact on DISCOMs?
Yes, absolutely. Okay. The DISCOMs are not supportive, and hence
the DISCOMs are not supportive.
Yes, because of the reason.
But overall, the state, you feel, is not fully engaged and not fully on board, because you think of two factors which I heard from you. One was perhaps in pockets, demand supply mismatch, and the impact on distribution companies, right?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody else has any other perspective here?
Policy and willingness go hand to hand. I mean, if you have made a policy, you might have made it with an intention to implement it. Policies will not be made, but it's certainly that somewhere we still lack on the implementation part of it. Be it, you say, Gujarat, which was one of the leading state in implementing solar at one point of time, and now adding nothing in utility and making it more difficult for the rooftop players to execute systems. So policy does exist, but most states out of maybe I would say 65 to 70% states in India now have a net metering policy, but most of these is still on paper. So till you start implementation of net metering policy and rooftop target of 40,000 megawatts will always be somewhere in the sky. You will never be thinking that I would be, you know, somewhere near close to that, where today you are between around 1200 to 1500 megawatts. So where do you go from here in 5 years to do that 40,000 megawatts? And the same is true on the utility. I mean, policy does exist now nowhere, but we need to make it a little more strong in terms of keeping an interest, not only the public interest, but also on the other side, developers' interest, is that why don't you make PPAs which have take or pay clauses? Why don't you make PPAs which are a little more bankable compared to what it is? Just by saying we have a two-tier payment security mechanism, typically those are, you know, still in question mark when you go to leading senior counsel lawyers as well as the leading banking institutions. Okay. So from their perspective, and developer would always see that if I'm investing this money as my equity, what will be my returns in future? I mean, the biggest risk in open access is not the tariff what you will get from your client, not the kind of off-taker what you have, but the biggest risk still is if your PPA says that any changes in wheeling banking charges is being taken by the developers, because client can say that you're offering me a landed tariff
of 5 rupees to put it at this ITC. What if today there is 50 paisa for the wheeling charge and tomorrow suddenly for some policy change it becomes 2.5 rupees? Who takes that risk?
Okay.
So that remains a question.
All right, so we've moved a little away from the subject that we started with, but Sabyasachi, you wanted to make a point here, right?
Just to add to that, I think more than the policy is also the stability of a policy. Because when you are setting up an asset, it takes you about 10 to 15 years to recover the cost of that. You make it on the basis of some assumption. If those assumptions are changed somewhere in between, then your entire project economics gets impacted. For example, Karnataka right now, of course, has a very supportive policy for renewables and open access. Now that, of course, was because, as he mentioned, that there was a deficit. But what happens if tomorrow Karnataka becomes surplus? Will they be still as supportive, or will they change the policies with or put additional charges? For example, Punjab, if you remember, was a very vibrant market for open access, not so much for renewables, because renewables was not a big player those days, but some hydro projects from northern India, as well as thermal guys who had surplus capacity, they were servicing the Punjab market. But as Punjab itself became, their board itself added to their capacities and signed up PPAs, later they really added a lot of additional charges which made the whole market unsustainable. So I think that is one of the risks that from a credit rating side we see, that changes in policies, particularly additional imposts and levies, can really impact the project economics.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you another, since you mentioned the bankability, okay. 2 points, which from a developer, whether rooftop or you know, grid scale, which are like sacrosanct to us, and which are apparently not so sacrosanct to the states, because it's already started to happen on the grid scale projects, where projects that were signed up several years ago, probably midway through their in their life cycle, there is talk of renegotiating the PPA price. Okay, and any challenge to the must-run status. How would that, in your opinion, as a financier, impact the entire sector, the entire renewable sector, especially solar?
On the PPA side, let me clarify. It was not so much, I'll answer it in two steps. It was not that, you know, PPAs which were already operational, where projects were running for several years, were put under question. Actually, a lot of the question marks had come in for those PPAs which for which the tariff period was up to 31st March, and some of those projects spilled over beyond the 31st March due date. And this was triggered particularly by the fact that FIT in several states was substantially higher than the 346. I mean, I agree the 346 does not mean the same thing in every state, but that was the way some of the states had interpreted it. So it was more for that. It's not that, you know, people who already had PPAs for several years and were supplying power. One or two instances were there, like in the case of Gujarat, but there, you know, the APTEL, you know, upheld the PPAs. So the risk for projects where, you know, PPAs are already operational and supplies are happening, the risks is not so much on repudiation of the PPAs, because that is legally challengeable, and going by what we have seen from Supreme Court and others, it's unlikely that they will permit unilateral you know, cancellation of the PPAs, and even the Ministry of Power is trying to, and MNRE are trying to convince, and in the case of Andhra Pradesh, they were also able to get them back on board that PPAs cannot be, they cannot refuse to sign the PPAs, or where, for example, regulatory approval was not taken, that was one of the things that was cited. They will have to take the regulatory approval and go ahead with the PPAs. More bigger risk could arise from the fact of, as you mentioned, of must run. What if must
run? So this, I'll just tell you where I'm coming from. This is from the recent, you know, paper from Niti Aayog, which has recommended that, you know, why must renewable have a must run status? Let's slowly phase it out.
Yes, I think that will be a very big risk. I mean, if, because we also saw in the case of Madhya Pradesh also, their draft, although it's not final yet, they also talked about must run not being there. And even if, let's say, and so basically in such cases where they find that the tariffs are higher, there's this practice of, you know, declaring that, you know, transmission capacity is not available. So obviously those things will have to be sorted out. They'll have to be, and there'll have to be some compensation for loss of generation because of not giving mustard, etc. And I think the new draft does address that, although not completely.